Okay, so now having rendered the system completely unstable and unproductive, we've got to rescue the situation. And at this point in time is usually a lot of corporate blame game playing. Usually the users are complaining and the application team are blaming the database and the database are blaming the operating system. When in fact, really, this is the challenge of one of architecture. So at this point in time, usually people are saying, I either want more connections to the database, or the database team are saying, I want less connections to the database. So at this point in time, what I'm going to do is reduce the number of connections down to a third of what we had, which was the 6,000. Let's do that and actually see what actually happens. At this point in time, we've totally lost the system. So at this point in time, we're going to rebuild the connection pool. And it's going to take a little while. And there's a lesson to be learned of the fact it takes a while to rebuild a large connection pool and tear it down. This is what happens when we have to do a failover. So if you were to be designing a system architecture, would you design an architecture with lots of moving parts that needed to be reestablished and failed over? That's something we need to consider when we design architecture for high performance as well as high architecture. Does it have the capability to fail over quickly? Okay, so you can see that we've recovered the system and actually cut down the connection pool. And as a result, we can see that the transaction rate has come back up again, the CPU utilization has come up. But the actual response time is, again, still fairly poor. It's up near to 40, nearly 100 milliseconds in itself. And so we still haven't actually solved the stability of the system. There still is wait events and contention going on inside the database. Here at this point in time, it's on a latch. Although the throughput is back on the system, but we can see that the response time is still bouncing around quite a little bit, although the CPU is up in the 90% utilization. Now, the fact that we reduce the number of connections, what I'd like to think about is, what happens if we had those connections set to 2,000 in the pool and we jumped it to 6,000? At this point in time, the system is still not ideal, but there would have been a faction of people saying, we need more connections. Now, we showed what happens when we went with a higher number of connections. We've just reduced it, but it's still not perfect by any stretch of the imagination in terms of the performance. So what we're going to start doing is taking a little bit of computer science. Remember when we were at school, we learned about time slicing and trying to schedule multiple processes onto a CPU. We learned very quickly that there'd be a point where if you overscheduled a CPU, you would actually get a lower throughput on the system altogether. And this is being played out on a bigger and bigger scale. Now, I know I have 24 cores or processors on this machine that I'm working on. So if I was to reduce this connection or the number of active processes more in phase with computer science and get it down closer to 24 or a small multiple of 24, let's think and see what would actually happen to the performance and the stability of the system. So at this point, I'm going to drop, instead of having over 2,000 connections in the pool, I'm going to take it to 144. And let's just apply that change. And let's just see what actually happens to both the throughput, the user response time, and actually the CPU on the system. Well, you can see we're now doing the transition, and you'll notice that very quickly that transition and re-establishing the connection pool took next to no time at all. Remember how long it took when we tried to come down from 6,000 to 2,000? It took a long time to transition across. That drop in that connection pool down to 144 was extremely quick. Imagine your failover being that quick. And now let's see what actually has happened to the system. It's quite dramatic. The only thing I have changed is the size of the connection pool. The workload is coming at me at the same rate. But if we actually look and see what's happening to the system, you'll notice that, one, the response time now is under 10 milliseconds of time spent both in the application server and on the database. We've got this huge drop down in response time. It's a much more consistent. We see slightly more throughput on the system. But what's more interesting is, look at the drop in the amount of CPU being utilized on the system. Now, this is where it becomes extremely difficult to argue in a highly charged escalation meeting, to explain to somebody that you want to reduce the number of connections so you can reduce the amount of CPU, so you can get faster response time and get more work through the system. At some point in what I've just said, I've contradicted myself. But the reality is we are actually using less CPU, we are getting higher throughput, and the response time is less. And half the clue is twofold. Is one, you'll notice we're not doing any contention events now inside the database. So all that CPU that we were wasting spinning on latches and arbitrating contention is now being redirected to actually process database transactions. And the other aspect of the thing is, because we're running fewer and fewer connections to the database, those connections are staying on the CPU, they're staying scheduled on the CPU for longer, and as a result, all memory pages associated with those processes are staying resident on the CPU cache. And as a result, they become more and more efficient at scheduling and they're stalling less on memory. And as a result, we just raise the performance game. So just to summarize, dynamic connection pools are extremely dangerous because they can destabilize the system really quickly. We showed that in slow motion as we incremented the workload. And then connection pools that are massively oversubscribing the system, i.e. 100, 1,000 times the number of cores on the system, are inherently inefficient and again can destabilize the system very quickly.